We call the cycling within the Earth system nutrient cycles, or biogeochemical cycles. Your book uses the term nutrient cycles, but I like the term biogeochemical cycles because just looking at the word, we can get a sense of how these cycles work. Biological, geological, and chemical processes are all involved. Regardless of their name, these cycles show us how matter cycles within the Earth system, which includes the biosphere, the lithosphere, solid Earth, the hydrosphere, and the atmosphere. In this video, we are going to look in detail at three cycles: the hydrologic cycle, the carbon cycle, and the nitrogen cycle. Though we will also briefly discuss the phosphorus cycle. For our assignment this week, you will be required to draw a pool and process model of one of the cycles. So be sure to pay attention to the cycles we describe here and to what it means to be a pool and process model. There are places within our Earth system where the material hangs out. We call these pools or reservoirs for particular substances. I use the term pool. And there are processes that bring the material from one pool to another. Notably, the material may hang out in a particular pool for a long time, thousands or even millions of years, or there may be some pools that the material passes through very quickly. The length of time a material typically stays within a given pool is called the residence time. You'll note that when we draw these models, the pools are depicted as labeled boxes, and the processes that bring material from one pool to another are depicted as labeled arrows. This is very important. Let's briefly consider the hydrologic cycle. The ocean is the largest pool in the hydrologic cycle. What process takes water out of the ocean? And what pool does it go to? It's not the clouds, not quite yet. Also, what processes, there is more than one, brings water into the ocean? And from what pools do those processes take water from? As noted previously, for this week's assignment, you will be drawing a pool and process model of one of the cycles. The diagrams I'm giving on the next several slides are not pool and process models. In particular, some of the diagrams really only do a good job of labeling processes. However, these diagrams may be helpful as you construct your own pool and process model. There will be more details on the assignment page. But as you work your way through the next few slides, pay attention to figuring out the specific pools and processes of each cycle. Think about the boxes that you will be drawing, the pools, and the arrows that will be connecting one box to another, the processes. Let's first dive into the water cycle. Really bad pun, I know. Of the three cycles that we are covering here, the hydrologic cycle, or water cycle, is likely the one that you are most familiar with. The image I'm showing here is infographic 14.2 from chapter 14 in your textbook. I encourage you to pause the video and check out this diagram. Specifically, check out the processes and the pools. The processes are pretty well laid out on this diagram, and they're labeled. I'd say 6 out of the 8 processes that I would put in a diagram are labeled pretty well here. The pools, though, are not labeled as well. In some of the texts, they do mention some of the pools, but they don't label them well, and they certainly aren't putting them in boxes like we're going to do in our pool and process diagram. I encourage you to stop the video here and check out this diagram. Look for what you think should be the pools and the processes. Generally, in the diagrams that we'll draw in this class for the hydrologic cycle, there'll probably be about 6 pools and 8 processes. Here's another model of the same cycle, the hydrologic cycle. This was taken from a textbook called Environment by Raven and Berg, 2011. you can see that, again, the processes are pretty well labeled, but many of the pools are only hinted at from the picture, although at least one of them is labeled here. So as you study these diagrams, consider the following. What are the primary pools in the hydrologic cycle? Where is the water hanging out? You should find at least six pools. The largest and most obvious pool is the ocean. Next, what are the primary processes? How does water move from one pool to another pool? You should find at least eight processes. Once you've figured out some pools and processes, your next step is to think about how they're related. Try to sketch out a model. Start with the ocean pool, put it in a box, and then draw a line from the ocean to wherever you think the water goes next. Label the process that brings it there, and label the pool where it ends up. You should also be considering what are some interesting, unique, or important characteristics of this cycle. Use your textbook or outside sources to come up with some ideas. And then finally, importantly for our class, consider what are some specific human impacts on the very specific pools and processes within this cycle. When considering human impacts, focus only on water quantity for now, not water quality. Take a moment and pause this video and sketch out some of the primary pools and primary processes for the hydrologic cycle. Also, jot down some of the interesting, unique, or important characteristics of this cycle, and jot down some ideas on how you think humans have impacted specific pools and processes in the cycle. Take some time to answer those four things before you move on. You are probably not quite as familiar with the carbon cycle compared to the water cycle. However, a good understanding of the carbon cycle is very important for many of the topics that we will cover in this class. For example, climate change, fossil fuels, deforestation, decomposition, etc. This is infographic 8.8 from your textbook. It does a pretty good job of the very simplest part of the carbon cycle. Again, it's not shown as a box and arrow model, which you will be drawing, but you can kind of get the idea. Starting with atmospheric CO2, if you put a box around that and properly named it atmospheric CO2, you can see then the process of photosynthesis brings it to producers, again with a box. And then the process of consumption brings it to consumers, with the box around consumers. And the process of cellular respiration takes it from the consumers back up to the atmospheric CO2 pool. Further, you can see another pool there, the decomposers. They show the producers undergoing the process of decomposition to lead to the decomposers. And I'd argue that consumers also get decomposed, so we could draw an arrow from the consumers to the decomposers as well. All right, we've got a pretty good start on the carbon cycle here, especially the terrestrial portion of it. Next, we have to remember, though, that the carbon cycle also occurs in the marine environment. That atmospheric CO2, we could draw an arrow to the CO2 in the oceans, the dissolved CO2 in the oceans. In fact, that arrow actually goes both ways. From the dissolved CO2 in the oceans, we can imagine that there's producers and consumers as well. So a very similar cycle is happening in the oceans. Where it's different, however, is that there's not much decomposition in the ocean sediments. So instead of having arrows labeled decomposition from the consumers and producers, perhaps it's just death and settling, leading down to a pool in the sediment at the bottom of the ocean. One important pool that we haven't mentioned yet that you'll need to put in your diagram is fossil fuels. So consider what processes create fossil fuels and from which pools those processes come. Then consider how fossil fuels, the carbon in fossil fuels, anyway, gets back up into the atmosphere. I've walked you a bit through the carbon cycle using the diagram in your book, but I've also included the diagram from Raven and Berg. When you're looking at these two diagrams, again, maybe pause the video and consider, what are the primary pools? What are the primary processes? And how are those pools and processes related? Try to sketch yourself out a model. Start with atmospheric CO2 and go proceed as we did on the previous slide. Also, you'll want to note some interesting, unique, or important characteristics of this cycle. Use your textbook or outside sources. And importantly, I'd like you to jot down a few things of how humans impact specific pools and or specific processes within this cycle. Notably, be sure to be able to note at least 2 to 3 ways that humans increase atmospheric CO2. All right, pause the video and try to answer these questions for yourself before moving on. The nitrogen cycle. This is likely the cycle you are least familiar with. It's fascinating, though, especially since it's nearly entirely run by bacteria. Every cell of our bodies needs nitrogen, and 78% of the air we breathe is nitrogen. Yet we have no way to incorporate that atmospheric nitrogen, N2, into our bodies. It's all around us, yet essentially unavailable. How then do we obtain the nitrogen we need? You'll have to figure that out. This is the diagram from our book, though I think the one from Raven and Berg is much more useful as we're trying to figure out how to draw a pool and process model. Start with the atmospheric nitrogen pool. You can see that nitrogen fixation leads to the creation of ammonia. So that's another pool. And then nitrification leads to the creation of the nitrate pool. And denitrification leads us back up to atmospheric nitrogen. That outer cycle, 3 pools and 3 processes. Then consider how plants and animals get their nitrogen. Check out this diagram and the previous one to figure it out. What pools and processes do you need to add? All right. As with the other pools, I encourage you to pause the video right now and consider, what are the primary pools? What are the primary processes? And how are they all related? Try to sketch the pools and boxes and the processes with arrows that connect the boxes. Next, what are some interesting, unique, or important characteristics of this cycle? Use your textbook or outside sources. And finally, how do humans impact specific pools or specific processes within the cycle? How do we increase or decrease some of these pools or processes? Take some time to answer these questions before you move on. Lastly, let's briefly look at the phosphorus cycle. I encourage you to consider pools and processes for this cycle as well, though it won't be part of the assignment that we'll be doing for this topic. One thing I do want to point out about the phosphorus cycle, though, is that it has no atmospheric component to it. The water cycle, the carbon cycle, and the nitrogen cycle all have a significant pool in the atmosphere, which ends up making those cycles quite global in nature. The phosphorus cycle does not have an atmospheric pool, and it tends to stay, the phosphorus tends to stay more localized in specific regions. Alrighty, your next task will be to create a pool and process model for either the water cycle, the nitrogen cycle, or the carbon cycle. See the assignment for details.